I thought I'd do just a little bit more thinking out loud and analysis of the 2018 local election results. First of all, cephology is the study or a branch of political science which is dedicated to the scientific analysis of elections. Polling is one thing about elections, but you know there are lots of things that go into making up how people vote, the context in which they vote, the time, the events, domestic events, international events. That dichotomy between international events or geopolitics and home events, in the doctoral thesis of Henry Kissinger, he for instance outlines the tragedy of Castlereagh, the foreign secretary of England that was very unpopular at home but considered quite indispensable to European geopoliticals at politics at the time, and he contrasts him with Metternich, who was the German foreign minister. That is from 1953, and I mean things haven't changed. The conduct of foreign policy is really not something which is being proved at the moment that domestic governments can afford to dwell on. I'm thinking of Saudi arms, sales to Saudi of arms, and also the support personnel who are over there at the moment loading and arming planes that are actually bombing and imposing a blockade, causing a humanitarian disaster in Yemen, a war crime. Anyway, what I thought I'd do is just get up the local election results since 2010 on Wikipedia, and then pick out a few years just to get a kind of an idea and just talk through them and make some points that occur as we go along. So on Wikipedia, I mean you can go to any year you like really, but I've started off with the local elections of 1995, and the 1995 local elections are presented slightly different to how they are presented in the decade of the 2010s onwards. Now, I'm not sure when the current system of having local elections every 4 years came in, so that you know all the seats have a churn in over a 4 year period, and that's not what this video is about. It's about actually, well, you know, who historically has done well and badly in elections. Now, this does say here that in the 95 election, when Tony Blair was a newly minted leader of the Labour Party, the percentage of the vote secured was 47%, securing 1,807 councillors. And John Major was leader of the Conservatives at that time, and had surprisingly beaten Neil Kinnock, you'll remember, in the 92 election. Was it 92 election? And then Blair got in 97. Paddy Ashdown, they had 23% of the vote and 487. Now, these were the days before UKIP. I'm not quite sure whether James Goldsmith's forerunner to UKIP had started at that time, but let's keep an eye on this figure here. The Tories have more councillors than Labour in this election, but the election, the Labour star is rising and the Tory star is on the wane, and the Liberal Democrats are coming up on the blind side. Go to 97. This is The elections were held on the same day as the general election in 97, which was a famous sort of Labour landslide. And then there's just not any of the same analysis here as to, it doesn't even say who ended up with what. Let's just have a look here. All 34 non-metropolitan counties, 21 of 46 unitary authorities, one out of 238 English districts, one sui generis authority, and all 26 Northern Ireland districts. But there isn't even a summary of the results for that on Wikipedia. So let's go then to the next one here. 2004, I picked this one because it's after the Iraq War has started, and so there have been the big protests, and it's really, I guess, when the number was up on actually Tony Blair being a con man. But here we see the swing away from Labour was -4%, a swing towards Michael Howard, not the most likeable of characters, was 2%, and 3% away from the Liberal Democrats and the very likeable character Charles Kennedy. So you can see Labour lost 8 councils, the Tories gained 13, and the Liberal Democrats lost 2 councils. But Labour at this point had 2,251 councillors and the Tories 1,700. So that's 2004, post the illegal Iraq war, which was not popular. Although if, as in those days, like me, you only read the dead tree corporate media, you would have had very little idea of how actually unpopular that was. Right, 2008. So this is a decade, no, it's not a decade on, 5 years further on. David Cameron is now the leader of the Tory party. Gordon Brown is now the Prime Minister, and the swing to the Tories in 2008 was 4%, and away from Gordon Brown 3%, and the Tories had 3,154 to 2,368 councillors, goodbye Labour. Then you've got Nick Clegg, who's with the Liberal Democrats, then they've gone up one council. Um, 2009, so this then is post economic crisis, the great crash. David Cameron's gone down 6%, Gordon Brown's down 1%, the Tories, although they had a swing of 6% away from them, picked up 7 more councils. Labour lost 4 councils, and the Liberal Democrats, with a 3% swing in their favour, lost a council. Well, go figure. By this time, it's obviously a question of, I mean, this is obviously the Tory shires really up for grabs here. Then we come into the present decade, 2010, which is the year of the election, which Cameron came to power as Prime Minister. The swing away from the Tories was 4%. They had 3,462 councillors to Labour's 2,976. There was a swing to Labour of 1%. The Tories lost 121 councillors and Labour gained 417. Held 6 May 2010, when the 2010 general election also took place. So that's that. 2011, obviously austerity would be kicking in, doesn't show the swing on the Tories there, but there's a swing to Labour of 10% and away from the Liberal Democrats of 11%, and the councils, Labour picked up 26 councils. Now, this was the turning point of a purple patch in Labour for getting local authority results. And what's interesting is the present 2018 saw a swing to Labour of 8%. Now, if this is a high watermark, the current election, regardless of what the naysayers and the briefers against Jeremy Corbyn, Momentum, Corbynistas, this sort of branding to smear and negate, there's an underlying thing here, and that is that if people are dissatisfied with government and austerity, which they clearly are, and with curved bananas, the sort of EU, people want to be listened to, and centralised forms of government are very bad at listening, and they're not sensitive to feedback from the system, if you apply systems theory to it. And so in 2011, austerity already showed a big swing to Labour, away from the Liberal Democrats, certainly, but the Lib Dems lost 748 councillors, and which enabled the Tories to pick some up, and Labour, who really benefited from that. What's the other thing we can say about that? What we can say there is that the rise of UKIP is not apparent at that stage. 2012, a 1% swing, obviously after a 10% swing the year before, it's to build on those kind of earthquake-like sort of movements in the political landscape is quite difficult. Here in this one you can see you've got the SNP up in Scotland and Leanne Wood in Wales applied there. So that's another 4% swing away from the Tories. Liberal Democrats make up a bit of ground, but they still lose a whole slew of councillors, 336. The Tories lose 405 as their austerity policies bite. 2013, again, what's interesting about this one is there's a 9% swing away from Ed Miliband in that one. But here you see UKIP coming onto the scene in a big way for the first time, where they picked up 139 councillors. And although there was a 9% swing away from Labour, they still picked up 291 councillors. It's quite interesting. 2014, here, this is just prior to the 2015, year of 2015 election, 2% swing to Labour, 4% to the Tories, 1% away from Nick Clegg, and 5% swing away from UKIP, although they still picked up 163 councillors. It just goes to show that one statistical measure is not necessarily an indicator of how the actual voting on the ground translates into sort of councillors' bums on council chamber chairs, as it were. So that's 2014. 2015, if we have a look at this, same day as the general election, and this is where Cameron beat Ed Miliband, basically a Tory beat Tory light, or austerity light lost out to full fat austerity, as it were. The Tories secured 35% of the popular vote, Labour 29%, a swing of 6% to the Tories from Labour, and a swing away from UKIP of 4%, but they still picked up 176 additional councillors. Now, that's interesting, because I think if you dig deeper into those numbers there, you'll actually find that headline statistical percentages are not necessarily a very good indicator to what happens in the inner workings of the machine, that's a clear case of this. There's a strong thing here. Obviously, the Liberal Democrats, who lost out big time in that election, Nick Clegg lost his seat in Sheffield Hallam, famously, which was the Michael Portillo moment of that election. But the swing 2% away from the Lib Dems as well. Let's look at 2016. 2016, Jeremy Corbyn is now the leader of the Labour Party. David Cameron is still the leader of the Conservatives, but the Conservatives have a swing of 5% away from them and 2% towards Labour. And let's just see, a 1% swing away from UKIP, but they still pick up 25 councillors. And I think this is where Brexit starts to get a grip, and we enter this paradigm shift and purple patch in political intrigues and an increase in public interest. And one of the strong things about the public interest in the political process at this stage is that there is now a real choice. The neoliberals will tell you there is still no alternative. Tina Sheehan must still be obeyed. But austerity, hugely unpopular. The EU and its neoliberal trade deals, sucking wealth into the centre of Europe, particularly into Germany from the periphery. The UK keeps the pound and so manages to maintain its position in the global pecking order, rather more than it would do if it had gone into the euro. There are complex international things, and if we look at Brexit as a geopolitical thing as opposed to a local political thing, domestic political thing, that is firmly in the domestic discourse as well. Then we come to 2017, when Brexit has already taken place, Mrs. May hasn't yet called the snap election, or had she? I'm not quite sure. But this is where there's a great deal of briefing against Jeremy Corbyn. No UKIP in 2017, where are we? We've got a swing away from Labour of 4%, lost 382 councillors, and of course, that I think you lay at the door of the divided Labour Party, where the Blairites try very hard to oust Jeremy Corbyn. There's a swing towards Theresa May of 8%, they pick up 563 councillors, the snap election is called. And this is one of the biggest political blunders in history from Theresa May. She loses her inherited majority from the 2015 election. Effectively, it gave her enough rope to hang herself. And then we come to 2018, and here we have it, a swing to Labour of 8%, away from the Tories of 3%, away from the Liberal Democrats of 2%. Labour pick up 82 councillors. The Tories lose 35, UKIP, you know, basically crash and burn. And the rest, as they say, is hot air and analysis paralysis. What this shows is that this showing by Labour in terms of a swing to Labour is the second best from 2011, which is the high water mark. And extrapolating from this to a general election, one has to be terribly careful because it's a quarter of the seats or councils across the country. It does include Nuneaton, and Nuneaton as a bellwether may tell us something. There's an excellent Roy Madrinet article about how to win the voters of Nuneaton, which is worth Googling. It's mind-boggling to think that people like Shukra Muna are actually saying we need to have a post-mortem because we're so disappointed and we've done so badly. That's absurd. It's an absurd abstraction away from any, even just confirmation-based, bias-based analysis of the figures. So there you have it. I mean, you can. I might actually spend a bit of time graphing some of this stuff, what seems incredibly evident here is that we've got this actors in history approach to, if we say it often enough, the captain said to the crew, if I say it once, it's enough, twice and thrice, and it's true, as in The Hunting of the Snark. But anyway, there we go. An interesting set of figures there to ponder. Whilst I think there may be a leadership challenge by the Blairite wing of the Labour Party, this really is a risible Tory performance. Theresa May is not getting her Falklands bounce from Syria, or this was the Falklands bounce in a way. The Scripples and Syria were supposed to shore up the Tories and run a deterrence line, if you like, or run cover for the Brexit fudge, which is coming up and is likely to bring down her government. So you can get quite a lot of good figures off Wikipedia, but putting them in a context and a timeline, you see it's actually one of the better Labour Party local election results and performances of recent times, including the high water mark of 2011.